First, I'm explaining how linear discriminant analysis works, followed by a Python code example implementing linear discriminant analysis on the Iris dataset. Stay tuned.
Three separate devices. This is one device.
Associate with people who are better than yourself. And
I'm going to make them an offer again.
Hey everybody, I'm Sam and this is Antiverso. Today we're talking about machine learning and in particular about linear discriminant analysis, or in short LDA. And this is my second video about it. In the first one, it was introduction to it plus a simple example. We talked about what is LDA, how does it work, more focused on the mathematical approaches as ideas of how they change our data set in such a way that it's more meaningful and it's easier for us to differentiate the different classes in it. If all of this sounds very abstract to you, I would advise you to go back and watch that video. It is in the card section, which is on the top right of your screen, or in the Antiverso Technology and Innovations playlist, which again you can find in the card section. And if you're here to find out more about machine learning basics, the ideas behind machine learning and artificial intelligence, how does it work, see a little example that's easy to understand, and a little introduction to neurons, neural networks, and something like that, again, I would advise you to go back into that card section or into the technology and innovations playlist and look at my machine learning basics introduction and simple linear regression videos. They would be very helpful for you. So just to recap, with linear discriminant analysis or LDA, it is used on data sets that have some kind of small or limited numbers of classes. In the picture that you're seeing now, there are two classes, red and green. And what LDA is trying to achieve is to change our system in such a way that it is easier to differentiate between the two classes. The way it does that is by finding optimal vectors, as the vector you can see here or here, which when our system is projected on, so all of our points are projected on, they are very well separated, as you can see here, the blue and the red one. What it does also is for higher dimensional systems that, for example, might have 4 or 5 or 1,000 dimensions. In the example today, I will be looking at 4-dimensional system. LDA gives us as much vectors as there are dimensions in the system, but also it gives us a value which represents how meaningful those vectors are, so we can choose only the ones that contain information. In that way, we can reduce, in the picture here, 2-dimensional system to just 1-dimensional. Or in the example today, a 4-dimensional system to again 1-dimensional system, which is very useful. And one more picture here, you can see again 3 classes. This is the best vector projected onto it. They are very well separated. Ta-da, we have just 1 dimension left. In order to find those optimal vectors or directions, LDA uses the Fisher ratio and tries to maximize it. And you can see the ratio here. It tries to maximize the distance between the means of the different classes, and also it tries to minimize their variance, or how spread the classes are. The best trade-off of those two values, which will give the maximum Fisher's ratio, results in the best separation between the classes, because they will be condensed and they will be as far away as possible. That can be represented by the histogram, which we can see here. This is basically how the system, the two classes, project onto our vector. Here we can see their variances, we can see their means, and we also can see how condensed they are. So where there are most points, and obviously that will be around the mean. And this is the idea that linear discriminant analysis uses to differentiate between classes. The way it mathematically does that is by using between class covariance matrices and total within class covariance matrix. And those are difficult names, but we can see their formulas there. They're using the means of the classes, where M2 and M1 are our means of the two classes, and Xn is the mean of our total system, which is basically all means added together, then divided by their number. And using those two matrices, we can solve this eigenvalue problem, where our W is our desired optimal direction. I'll show you that in a bit with Python code, so it will be even more clear. As I mentioned earlier, today we'll be looking at four-dimensional problem with three classes to differentiate, and that is the Iris dataset. It is quite famous in the machine learning society because it's very old dataset, but is very useful for, you know, simple representation of machine learning algorithms. And the Iris dataset is basically those three different types of the same flower, and our data will be the petal and the sepal lengths and widths. That's why I said they are four dimensions, because there are four features for each sample. And here, this is the projection of the original dataset into our four dimensions. This is in dimension 0, and we can see that our classes are overlapping, so it's basically almost impossible to differentiate between them. This is in dimension 1, again, strong overlapping. Dimension 2 actually is much better, but still quite a lot of overlapping between Versicolor and Virginica. And dimension 3, once more overlapping between Versicolor and Virginica. So obviously I can't plot the whole thing because there are four dimensions, but that's how the dataset looks in each of the dimensions. So it's very hard to actually differentiate mostly between Versicolor and Virginica. Now, using the linear discriminant analysis, I'll bring the dataset down to two dimensions and then even to one dimension, and transform it in such a way that it's much easier to differentiate between classes. So let's look a little bit at the code. And first of all, let me tell you that if you're not very good, or if you haven't looked at Python before or NumPy, it is absolutely okay not to understand everything from the startup, but you know, try typing that up and it will get clearer and clearer. There is nothing too complex or, you know, too out of this world here. I've tried to make very simple and easy code. So here I have just inputted my Iris dataset. And here I have the three Iris classes, which I'm taking from the Iris dataset. And I'm doing that just so it's easier for me. Here I'm plotting the histograms in the four dimensions, which we saw a second ago. And then I go about finding the optimal W. The optimal W are those optimal vectors that will give us the best differentiation between the classes. And as we are in four dimensions, we'll get four vectors, directions or weights, whatever I'm calling them, we're talking about the same thing. And each vector has its eigenvalue, with this value actually showing how meaningful that vector is. I explained that more in the previous video. The eigen problem, which I mentioned here, when we solve it, we get eigenvectors and eigenvalues for our system, which is basically at the moment a distribution of the three classes. So how do we do that? First of all, I get the mean of the three classes. As we saw here, we need the means everywhere. Later, I go about calculating the between class covariance matrix. So first of all, I get the overall Iris mean, so the whole data set or system's mean. I go about calculating the difference between them. It's basically just doing that, right? Now I just have for each class those elements. Once I do that, I multiply the matrices by dots and I get the between class class covariance matrices for each class, and then I just add them together and I get for the whole system. And the total within class covariance matrix, which is basically trying to make the classes as dense as possible, so their variances to be as small as possible. And the between class covariance matrix is trying to make their means as far away as possible, which is basically fulfilling the Fisher ratio, right? Trying to maximize it. So the way we do that is, here I'm just taking a single sample of the Setosa class at the moment, and then I'm calculating its variance, and then I'm calculating the scatter matrix by adding the dot multiplication of the variance and the variance transpose, which is pretty simple thing to do, and it is just fulfilling this thing we see right here. Those are variances for each class. Here I get my total within class covariance matrix by again adding the three classes, and once I have that, I'm ready to get my eigenvalues and eigenvectors by solving the eigenvalue problem with the between class covariance matrix and the within class covariance matrix. Here I just reorder things by their size and later print them. So let's take a look at that. As you can see here, those are our solution, iris eigenpairs sorted by eigenvalue. Here is our eigenvectors, and those are the eigenvalues. As you can see, this eigenvalue is much, much bigger than any of the others. Actually, I believe if you divide them one to the other, this eigenvalue should hold more than 99% of the information, meaning that perfectly fine to choose only this direction for best separation, and we'll see that in a second. However, the second vector also holds a little bit of the information, which is probably less than 0.5%, and those two are basically zero. The only reason they have some kind of value, which is very little, is because of lack of precision, because obviously when I'm calculating things, I have a set precision. So for now, just for a better representation, I use my optimal weight, vector, direction, whatever we would like to call it, to be the sum of the first vector and the second vector, which we can see here. And this is our iris data set after linear discriminant analysis, brought down to two dimensions from four. And as we can see, we have very good separation. This is the Setosa, this is the Versicolor, and this is the Virginica. Once again, Virginica and Versicolor have a little bit of overlapping points, but they are very, very little compared to what was before. And as we said, the first vector basically holds almost all of the information. In here we can see that once more. In the first dimension, which is the first vector, we can see how well the three classes are separated. They have very little variance, so they are very condensed. Most of the points are on their means, which is what we can see here. There are a lot of points on the means, and that results obviously from the Fisher's ratio in very good separation. This is in the dimension 2, so this is basically our system projected to the LDA dimension 2, and we can really see that they're basically absolutely overlapped, which is what we expected, right? Because it holds very little part of the information. I hope that made it much more clearer to what linear discriminant analysis is, how it's done. I have quite a lot more code in there, which probably when I scrolled you saw, but those will be in next episodes, where we'll be talking about logistic regression, which is very interesting because it combines linear regression, what we talked about in the first videos, and linear discriminant analysis, what we talked today in my previous video. So I hope that helped you, you enjoyed it, and you know, if you have any questions, please ask me in the comments and I'll do my best to try to answer them. look around TensorFlow. I have a lot of interesting videos, machine learning, different technologies, great people's ideas and interviews, speeches about what they believe that will change your life, and a lot of good music. Stay TensorFlow and see you next time.